Welcome to Relativity 102, the keys to the mathematics of relativity. In Relativity 102, I'll be explaining what I think are the two most important mathematical ideas for understanding the math behind relativity. And those key ideas are number one, invariance, and number two, the twin concepts of covariance and contravariance. Now, some viewers might already be scared by these big, abstract-sounding words. First, I'll say that these ideas aren't as hard as they sound. And second, I'm going to spend a couple minutes explaining why I'm introducing these concepts right away, instead of explaining relativity about familiar things in the real world, like trains and planes. In Relativity 101, I gave an introduction to the concepts of relativity without using too much math. But I'm assuming viewers who are watching these later videos are willing to put in more effort to understand relativity, and that many of you will be here for the long term. By long term, I mean I expect you're going to use this series to understand Galilean relativity, the relativity of everyday life, special relativity, the relativity we see when going close to the speed of light, and general relativity, which is the modern theory of gravity. Now, I suspect most people watching will find Galilean relativity very easy. Special relativity will be a little bit confusing, but I'm assuming most people will understand after thinking about it for a while. Meanwhile, general relativity has a reputation for being very difficult, and I'm a little bit afraid that some people watching might give up before they ever finish it. This is why I'm introducing the ideas of invariance, covariance, and contravariance as early as possible, even if the ideas are a little bit abstract. These ideas are found in all three theories of relativity, and the sooner you understand them, the easier things will be in the future. So I'm hoping that, by introducing invariance, covariance, and contravariance at the very beginning, before Galilean relativity, you'll be so used to these ideas that general relativity won't be as difficult. So what do these fancy words actually mean? Roughly, invariance is the idea that the same object can be described in different ways from different points of view. And covariance and contravariance roughly refer to the idea that when one thing grows, another thing shrinks, and opposite changes will balance out. To make these concepts more concrete, we need to talk about vectors, which for our purposes are basically like arrows. Vectors have both a length and a direction that they point in. Vectors can represent all sorts of things in physics, like position, momentum, and velocity, so for that reason we'll be using them all the time in relativity. I'm hoping you already know that we can scale vectors. For example, if I multiply a vector by 2, that vector becomes twice as long, pointing in the same direction. And if I multiply a vector by negative 1, it keeps the same length but reverses its direction. I'm also hoping you know how to add vectors. If we add a bunch of vectors together, we can get the result by placing them one after another, tip to tail, and drawing the resulting vector starting at the tail of the first vector and ending at the tip of the last vector. So let's start off by talking about the invariance of vectors, or how the same vector can be described in different ways from different points of view. Let's take a look at using vectors to describe the separation between points in a flat 2D plane. For example, if we have a table with a pencil sitting on it, we can describe the separation between the pencil's eraser and the pencil's tip using some basis vectors, ex and ey. You might have heard of these vectors called by other names, like x hat and y hat, or maybe I hat and j hat, but their names aren't too important. Ex gives us one unit in the horizontal direction, and ey gives us one unit in the vertical direction. Ex and ey basically give us a coordinate system for the 2D plane. And we can add together ex and ey in different amounts to get from the pencil's eraser to the pencil's tip. In this case, the separation between the pencil's eraser and tip is given by 4 horizontal vectors and 3 vertical vectors. Writing this in math notation, we get 4ex plus 3ey. But we can also measure this pencil using a different set of basis vectors. For example, a pair of basis vectors that are rotated by some angle. We'll call these new rotated basis vectors ex tilde and ey tilde. And using these basis vectors to describe the pencil, we find the pencil is equal to 5ex tilde basis vectors and 0 ey tilde basis vectors. Now, there's a really, really important idea going on here. We see that the pencil separation can be described in two different ways, using different numbers, depending on which basis vectors we're using. We can express the pencil in terms of the EX and EY basis vectors and get the components 4, 3, or we can express the pencil in terms of the EX tilde and EY tilde basis vectors and get the components 5, 0. Now, the pencil is a physical object and it's not changing, but the pencil can have different components if we measure it using a different coordinate system, or in other words, different basis vectors. And this is the main idea behind invariance. The pencil is invariant, or in other words, it's not changing, but the pencil's components can change depending on how we measure it. In Relativity 101, I gave the example of how a muon particle that's stationary will live for about 2 microseconds on average before it decays. But the same muon, if it's moving at close to the speed of light relative to the Earth, scientists on the Earth will observe the muon living for about 20 microseconds, 10 times longer, because of time dilation, before it decays. And this sounds pretty crazy, but it's not hard to explain if we use vectors and the idea of invariance. If we observe the muon creation and its later decay in spacetime, the separation between these two spacetime points can be measured using vectors. With this coordinate system, the decay time can be measured to be 2 microseconds. But in another coordinate system, the decay time can be measured to be 20 microseconds. Time dilation in special relativity is really just the result of measuring space-time points using different basis vectors, or in other words, a different coordinate system. This is almost the exact same thing as measuring the pencil using our different basis vectors and getting different components as a result. The only difference between the pencil and the muon decay is that for the pencil example, our vector lives in 2D space, measured with x and y. But the decaying muon is measured in space-time, using x and t. Now, I understand that the concept of space-time vectors might seem confusing right now. And again, I'll be explaining this in greater detail in later videos. I'm just trying to prepare you for the idea that measuring a vector using a different basis can give us different results. And this idea is very important in relativity. So this is the main idea behind invariance. Invariance means the same object can be described in different ways using different points of view. More specifically, the same vector, which is invariant and unchanging, can have different components when measured in a different basis. Later in this series, we'll talk about tensors. A tensor is just another word for an invariant object, something that's unchanging that we all agree on, but that can have different components if we measure it using different coordinate systems. And we'll see that we can write tensors as arrays. For example, we can write the vector 4ex plus 3ey using array multiplication, with the basis vectors in a row and the vector components in a column. We just use the array multiplication rule of first entry times first entry to get 4x, and second entry times second entry to get 3ey.